Thank you. Good morning, and welcome this morning to our service. And as you all know, or most of you know, Pastor Castile is away on holiday. So this morning it'll be your elders leading the service and playing the music. We've got Greg on the organ and piano, and you have two Davids here who will be taking the service. We're going to follow the order of service, confession and absolution in the hymnal on page 151 and prayer and preaching on page 260, but also the service will be on the monitors as well. One thing I wanted to mention to you is that the sermon today has been written by Pastor Schultz. And so he has taken pity on Pastor Castile as well, and has allowed Pastor Castile to go away without having to write a sermon. So Pastor Schultz has written the sermon, "Do You Believe in Miracles?" I want to bring your attention to the flowers that are on the altar this morning. And they are given to the glory of God by Daniel and Alessandra Mittman, in celebration of their 9th wedding anniversary and also Alessandra's parents' 50th wedding anniversary. And I don't see Alessandra here yet, but I'm assuming Alessandra and Daniel will be here shortly. Their family is already here. Mom and Dad are sitting in the back on my left. And then in front of Mom and Dad are Alessandra's sister, husband, and two of their children visiting from the States. So we welcome them here today. And we welcome any visitors, other visitors as well, who are with us today. I think that's all I'm going to... One thing I'm going to mention as well is that we'll have the summer midweek service this Wednesday, July 24th, and then on August 7th and August 21st. All these services will be at 7 p.m., and they will be with Holy Communion. And finally, David has reminded me that We're going to have coffee this morning after service. Everybody is welcome to stay and join in with the coffee. So we're ready to begin our service, and so we ask you to please rise as we sing, "Send, O Lord, Your Holy Spirit."
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins,
God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please kneel, or sit, or stand as you are able. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Please rise for the opening vesticles. This is the day which the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
From the rising of the sun to its setting,
the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere.
I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked.
Make me to know your ways, O Lord.
Teach me your paths.
Sanctify us in your truth.
Your word is truth.
From the rising of the sun to its setting,
in the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name. seated as we hear the Bible.
The Old Testament reading for today is from Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 1 through 6. The remnant of God's flock will be gathered. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, declares the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who care for my people. You have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. Behold, I will attend to you for your evil deeds, declare the Lord. Then I will gather the remnant of my flock out of all the countries where I have driven them, and I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will set shepherds over them who will care for them, and they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall any be missing, declares the Lord. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days, Judah will be saved, and Israel will dwell securely. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading for today is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. Together we are fellow citizens with God's people. Remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The gospel reading for today is from Mark chapter 6, verses 30 through 34. Jesus miraculously feeds thousands of people. Please rise for the gospel. The apostles returned to Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. And he said to them, "Come away by yourselves to a desolate place and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a desolate place by themselves. Now many saw them going and recognized them, and they ran there on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd and had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And when it grew late, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a desolate place, and the hour is now late. Send them away to go into the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But he answered them, "You give them something to eat." And they said to him, "Shall we go and buy 200 denarii worth of bread and give it to them to eat?" And he said to them, "How many loaves do you have? Go and see." And when they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then he commanded them all to sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat in groups by hundreds and by fifties, and taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and said a blessing and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples to set before the people. And he divided the 2 fish among them all, and they all ate and were satisfied. And they took up 12 baskets full of broken pieces and fish. And those who ate the loaves were 5,000 men. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly set in the heavens.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Blessed are those who hear the word of God and keep it.
Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit.
Lord,
we say the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated as we sing the sermon hymn, "Christ is our Cornerstone."
Thank you. Again, I want to thank Pastor Schultz for having written the sermon for this morning. Do you believe in miracles? Pastor Schultz starts his sermon off by saying, "Dear believers, do you want to see a miracle? I know just the place to go. Mind you, many people have gone there, but have gone away without seeing one. It's a miracle that not everyone can see. That privilege is given to special people who really are no better or worse than you or I. No, you don't have to travel to some faraway holy place and drink some special holy water that has been specially blessed to experience this miracle. No, this miracle can be seen without leaving London or Strathroy or Kamoka or St. Thomas or wherever you reside. I've seen it, though I must confess, I take it for granted. Others have seen it. They have not always been conscious of it, but it's still there. Still others have seen it and doubt whether it's a miracle at all. But there is no doubt it is one of God's mysteries. It's a miracle. The miracle I'm talking about is the church. I'm going to narrow this down to faith and grace and everyone who calls faith and grace my church. You see, there are a whole lot of people who call faith or grace my church, even though we don't see them very often on Sunday mornings. And when new people enter our buildings, are we excited they are here? Or are we concerned that they will fit in with the rest of us? But that's the miracle I'm talking about. The church is made up of people as individuals who are so different and diverse. During the week, each of us is separated and divided by a whole host of things: distance, different interests, different workplaces, and different leisure activities, and perhaps different ethnic backgrounds. After the service, many drive away quickly to start doing whatever it is they do for the rest of the day. In the church, there are people with a basic and simple understanding of the Christian faith. And there are those who have been well grounded in Lutheran theology, may have been to courses, seminars, or even have degrees in what the church teaches. With so many people with such differing backgrounds, interests, and inclinations, it shouldn't surprise us that while we may be polite and helpful to each other, it's not possible to be best friends with everyone, the kind of friends who confide in each other and in whom we have every confidence and go to in times of need. There may be some who get on our nerves a bit. There are some who we know have made a bit of a mess of their lives at some time. And yet, when they turn up at the church door, we welcome them as part of our church. There are some we hardly know at all. So there's the mystery, the miracle: people coming together. They may not come every week, and maybe hardly at all, but still, they are drawn to call faith and grace my church. What draws them together? Of course, I can't speak on behalf of everyone and say what motivates them to do this, but I believe the majority of people feel there is something different about the church and are happy to call it my church. This is what I call the miracle of the church. Paul spoke of this kind of miracle when he wrote to the Ephesians. People in Paul's day were divided into two classes of people, Jews and non-Jews, or Gentiles, as they were called then. They mixed about as well as oil and water. Where there is an attitude of superiority and self-interest, it is inevitable that people find themselves pitted against each other. The Jews saw the Gentiles as a threat, and the Gentiles saw the Jews as a threat. The two didn't mix. Their religions clashed. One acted superior to the other, and when that happened, it was evident that they would never get on. The Apostle Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 14, Christ himself has brought us peace by making Jews and Gentiles one people. With his own body, he broke down the wall that separated them and kept them enemies. Remember, the Jews and Gentiles had been enemies for centuries. But by his death on the cross, Jesus united everyone together. There's a miracle for you. Jesus brought together people of such different and diverse backgrounds and interests. He made them fellow citizens, to use Paul's own words found in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 19. This whole section of Paul's letter emphasizes how the death of Jesus on the cross brings healing and reconciliation between people. What separates people out there in the world has no place in the church. There is acceptance because of Jesus Christ. People are happy to call this my church because regardless of their backgrounds, culture, interests, political opinions, variety of occupations, and even different understandings of what Christianity is all about, all this diversity has come together to form the church. We are united by Jesus Christ. We have heard his voice and followed his call. He has brought about something that at first would seem to be impossible. There is only one thing holding these people together, and that is Jesus Christ. You get a hint of this in the gospel reading today. A large crowd, many people from all the towns, went out to meet Jesus. In that crowd must have been people of all occupations, the rich, the poor, the young, the elderly, the craftsmen, the laborers, the tax collectors, the Pharisees, the curious and the seekers, everyone. They went out for one purpose, to see and hear Jesus. In spite of their diversity, there was unity. Down to the last man, woman, and child, they were there to see and hear Jesus. People like you and the people sitting around you come to the church, our church, because we find Jesus. Jesus makes a difference to the way we see and treat each other. We are no longer strangers and foreigners, as Paul says. Here in the presence of Jesus, there is acceptance. Jesus loves us, and we pass on that love to those who join with us around Jesus. And we accept them just as Jesus accepts us. We know from our own experience how much warmth and genuine care and acceptance are appreciated when we step into a strange environment. And here's the point. It's nice to talk about acceptance and love and care in the church and to talk about breaking down the barriers. But these barriers are so easily created because we like to define who is in and who is out, who are genuine and who are using the church for what they can get out of it. Those who are in it for the long haul and want to serve in so many ways because they really want to see things happen. And those who are uncertain and not ready to commit. Now that's a reality check about how things really are in the church. And of course, none of that is new. Isn't that just what we find in the New Testament? Just read Paul's letters to those early churches, like the one at Corinth. The church is not a perfect community. In every congregation, there are problems. Some people may hold opinions and points of view that make others feel awkward or even threatened. People avoid one another, don't talk to one another, stop attending worship because someone has upset them. A congregation is made up of sinful people, and there are plenty of weaknesses to be found. We are a mixed bunch, and we get upset with each other so easily. Relationships can be very fragile, and yet we still keep coming together. We still keep responding to the call of the Lord. It's a miracle. What is it that draws us together? It's obvious from what happens in worship that things have not gone all too well for the worshipers, and they realize their weaknesses. So at some point in the service, we confess our sins. Disobedience is a mark of our lives. We are cut off from God. We build up a dividing wall between us and our Heavenly Father, a wall of sin. It is a wall that destroys our relationship with God, a wall that destroys our relationship with other people. We are very good at building walls between us and others. We promote our own interests first, and we so easily cut ourselves off from other people. But by his death on the cross, Jesus has broken down the wall that we put up between each other. We receive Christ's forgiveness, and Christ now sends us out to break down the walls that separate us from others, walls of anger, hatred, prejudice, intolerance, jealousy, and unkindness. Forgiveness and love are the binding glue of God's family. All this is Christ's doing. It is a miracle. It's his miracle. We share together bread and wine and Jesus' body and blood in Holy Communion. Through this eating and drinking, we are sharing the same Christ. We are receiving the same blessings from Jesus. We are expressing our oneness and togetherness through the sacrament. All this regardless of who we are and who the other person is. We are one in the body of Christ, the church. We leave our seats and gather at the foot of the altar. Perhaps you kneel or stand or sit next to a person you haven't seen for a long time. Perhaps it is someone you don't particularly like. Perhaps it's someone you've had harsh words with. Or perhaps it is a total stranger. Do you see what's happening? When you come to this altar, drawn by the Lord, you share together the same body and blood of the same Lord. You not only come closer to your Lord, but you also come closer to one another, even if you weren't at the same table. Little by little, the things that divide vanish. That is a miracle. And as this is happening, we are all growing together into Christ. The wall of hostility between people has come down. The wall between parents and children, when one fails to understand the other, the wall between husband and wife, between neighbors, between strangers. We cover the landscape of our lives with those ugly partitions that destroy fellowship, that leave no room for love and friendship. We are the ones to bring the peace of Christ so that forgiveness, friendship, and love fill the gap where there was once hostility. We are to be the ones who are the catalyst to bring about reconciliation between people. So this is a miracle. Those who meet to worship are celebrating this miracle. In fact, if you are worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ, you are a miracle. Yet it is not our miracle, it is the Lord's. From all the diversity that exists in his church, he makes us one body, his people. That the church exists at all, made up of sinful people, that's a miracle. If you want to see a miracle, look around you and see the church. In the name of him who is the head of the church, Jesus the Christ, amen. We receive the offering. Please rise as we pray together. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this nation, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphan, and for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, especially Stephen and Eileen, for Philip and his brother, for Eileen, for AJ, Jordan, for Judy, for Glenda, for Mandy, who has stage 4 throat cancer, for Bill, Rosie, for Michelle, for Ruth, Nancy, Ellen, Justin, Isabel, Luddy, Mary, for Shirley, for Tom, for Corey, for Pastor Schultz, for Pastor Ron, for Pastor Gerald and his wife Doreen, for Pastor Ted, for Linda, for Wes, for Barb and Stu, for Lloyd and Elsie, Patricia, Dorothy, Karen, Alice, Marcia, Rachel and her children, for Jason, for Walter and Donna, Becky, Anna, Delbert, Grace, Nancy and Stan. As well, we pray for those we name in our hearts before the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. For all the families of this congregation, especially for Franco and Betty, David and Erica, Anna, both, Niabil, Niawer, Guy, Tiwat, Gatqua, Niagawa, Neri, Niamut, Niamuch, and Niagawa. Father, grant that our families on earth reflect your fatherly care. Bless each of them with your divine presence and guard them from all harm and danger. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who celebrate their birthdays this week, especially for Kahle, Nikki, Samantha, Ian, Joyce, Sherry, Evan, Krista, Sarah, and Octavia, that our Lord grant them his blessing all the days of their life and keep them in faith till the end. As well, we pray for those who are celebrating their wedding anniversaries this week, especially for Walter and Donna, Jim and Lillian, Daniel and Alessandra, Rolf and Swellen, and Cody and Amber, that their marriages be a constant reflection of God's love for his church, and keep them in love, unity, and always respecting and forgiving each other until the end of their life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Heavenly Father, though we do not deserve your goodness, still you provide for all our needs of body and soul. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may acknowledge your gifts, give thanks for all your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and take them to heart, that by the patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. Grant my hands, I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. Bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Almighty and Merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve us.
Amen.
Thank you all for coming this morning. Remember, there's coffee downstairs. Join us if you can. And have a good week. Go and praise the Lord.